Hello all. In our previous lecture, we talked about the tabu search algorithm. We learned the main idea and general principles of the tabu search algorithm. In this lecture, we are going to talk about another widely used meta-heuristic algorithm, which is called the simulated annealing. We will talk about the general structure of this algorithm and provide the pseudocode of the algorithm. An important characteristic of simulated annealing algorithm is the temperature, which is a parameter of the algorithm. We will talk in detail in this lecture, and we will talk about the cooling schedule of this temperature. Again, another important characteristic of the simulated annealing algorithm is it is a random type algorithm. It uses some random numbers or randomness in the search, and in order to accept a non-improving move, it uses a probability. So we will consider this acceptance probability, and we will learn it, and we will solve an example problem using simulated annealing to understand it better. So let's get started. Simulated annealing is another meta-heuristic algorithm which is inspired by statistical thermodynamics. So simulated annealing is based on an analogy with the cooling of material in a heat bath. In the annealing process of materials with a cooling schedule, special properties of the materials are tried to be improved. And this analogy is used to find the best solution in an optimization problem. So it is one of the oldest and most widely used algorithms because it is very simple, maybe the easiest algorithms to implement. As I said, there is a great deal of literature, a great amount of applications in real life and in academy on simulated annealing. And simulated annealing converts to global optimum under weak assumptions, but the thing is, it is still a heuristic algorithm. So when we are talking about a heuristic algorithm, you should always keep in mind that there is no guarantee of optimality. We can say that simulated annealing is a modified random descent algorithm. So when we are sometimes in definition of tabu search as well, we are saying steepest ascent, mildest descent, or random descent algorithms, and etc. So in fact, do not be confused with these statements. If you are solving a minimization problem, you try to reduce the value of the objective function. That's why we are using the term descent. But if it's a maximization problem, then it should be an ascent algorithm. Okay, but when we say a descent algorithm, we do not lose the generality, because every minimization problem or every maximization problem can easily be converted to a minimization problem by basically multiplying the objective function with negative. So in simulated annealing, what we do, we select a neighbor, one of the neighbors randomly. So this is one of the differences of simulated annealing from tabu search in classical tabu. By the way, there are no strict rules in these algorithms. So you can modify any part of the algorithm if you feel or it will be better, or if you prove that it will provide better solutions. So for example, in tabu search, we said that we have an initial solution or we have a current solution. We check the neighbors of this solution. These neighbors can be generated by different neighborhood operators, such as insertion, pairwise exchange, flipping, and etc. Okay, so let's assume that we have this current solution, and we generate all the neighbors and we calculate their objective function values, all of them, and then we select the best one. Even if this best one is worse than our current solution, we make the move if this is not taboo. But in simulated annealing algorithm, when we have a current solution, we do not generate all the neighbors. We randomly generate one of them, and we check it is objective function value. So let's say that this current solution has an objective function value of f, let's say fk, and this has a solution, let's say fc, to represent candidate solution. So if fc, for a minimization problem, if fc is less than fk, so for a minimization problem, if fc is better than fk, we always accept this, okay, which means that we go to this solution. But if fc is greater than fk, then we decide whether to accept this move, whether to go to this neighbor or not, with a probability. Okay, so we do not accept every one of them, we accept some of them with a probability, and this probability, we will talk about it in more detail, but it depends on how much the objective function deteriorates and on the temperature. So this temperature is coming from the analogy, from the thermodynamics, from the cooling schedule. It's a parameter, or maybe it is the only parameter of simulated annealing. And by this way, it tries to escape from the local optima. But again, this is a heuristic algorithm and there's no guarantee of optimality. So let's assume that we are trying to develop a simulated annealing algorithm for a minimization problem. Then we calculate, in order to accept a move or not, in order to decide to accept or to make a move to this new neighbor or not, we first calculate the change in the objective function values. And the change in the objective function value is calculated by the objective function value of the neighbor minus objective function value of the current solution. So let's say this is our current solution, as I said, it is fk, and the neighbor, objective function value of this candidate, the neighbor, is fc. Then we calculate fc minus fk, and this we say that as the change in the objective function value delta. If delta is less than zero, what does it mean less than zero? So let's say that this is 100 and this is 80. So 80 minus 100 is minus 20. So from 100 to 80 for a minimization problem is an improvement, which means that if delta is less than zero, it is an improvement, and when there is an improvement, we always accept this. Always accept. Okay. Otherwise, if delta is greater than zero, so let's assume that we have this solution 80, current solution, and the neighbor solution is 100. Then we calculate 100 minus 80 as delta, which is 20, and when delta is greater than zero, we calculate a probability value, which is calculated as e to the power minus delta over t. So this delta is this 20, so we calculate e to the power minus 20 over t. So this T is temperature, we will talk about it. We will give its value, okay? As the designer of the heuristic, we will set its value. There is no value for that. We will see its effect later on. Okay, then we calculate this value. Then in order to decide to accept this solution or not, we will generate a random number between 0 and 1. Okay, so let's say that this value over here is 0.4, So what does it mean? It says that accepting a non-improving move, a deteriorating move, is 40%. Okay, so then let's say that this is the region between 0 and 1. So 0.4 is over here. So we say that this region over here is the acceptance region. Okay, accept. And this region over here is rejection region. And we generate a random number between 0 and 1. If that random number falls into this region, then we accept. Otherwise, if it falls into this region, we reject. Okay, so this is how we accept a non-improving move. If the move is not accepted, okay, so we are in this current solution, we try a neighbor. So neighbor is a non-improving one. We try this probability and we said that the decision is reject. Then we ignore this one and generate another random of this current solution. And if it is improving, accept it directly. If it is not improving, let's say this is 120, again calculate this probability and try to identify if you accept it or not. And do it as many times as required. So in this meta-heuristic algorithms, we said that non-improving moves are allowed. So in taboo search, non-improving moves are allowed in any case if they are not taboo and if they are the best solution of the current neighbors. In simulated annealing, non-improving moves are allowed with this probability. Okay, they are still allowed, but with a probability. Okay, but in taboo search, we said that one of the drawbacks of allowing non-improving moves is to fall into cycling. Okay, and in taboo search, we prevent this cycling behavior by forbidding the activities for several iterations, forbidding the moves for several iterations. Okay, so we can summarize it like this. In order to escape from local optima, we want to escape from local optima, we allow non-improving moves. But when we allow non-improving moves, this may lead to cycling. In order to prevent the cycling, in taboo search, we use taboo moves. In simulated annealing, what is the procedure of preventing this cycling behavior? It is the probability. Okay, it is the rules of probability. How does it work? Basically, again, let me sketch my drawing. Let's assume that we have this and we started from this point. Okay, so let's assume that with simulated annealing, we reach to this point. Now we generate a neighbor randomly, and let's assume that it is this neighbor. Then this is a maximization problem, assume. So we calculate this probability, and we decide to accept this probability. Then we generate a neighbor, but that neighbor again will be generated randomly. So that neighbor can be this one or any other one. Okay, so we may come back to this point or come back to this point again. Since it's an improving move, if it is randomly selected, if this neighbor is randomly selected, we can return back to that one. But then when we are at this point, again we will generate a neighbor randomly, and that neighbor can be this one or another one. Okay, so this random probability prevents us to select the same neighbors again and again. So if this is the current solution, and if we have, let's say, just four neighbors, this neighbor has a chance of selection of 1/4, because we are selecting the neighbors with a probability. Now let's assume that we went to this neighbor, then this neighbor, this solution has four neighbors, And this one has a chance of selection of 1 over 4. So going to this neighbor and returning back to this neighbor has a chance of 1 over 16. And then going back to this solution is multiplied by 1 over 4. And returning back to this solution is multiplied by 1 over 4. And you see, making a cycle of 2 turns has a probability of 1 over 64. And as it is very, very small probability, it is nearly zero to get into an infinite loop, infinite cycling behavior. Yes, maybe you can cycle 2 times, 3 times, but the probability is very, very small. So in TabuSearch, the method for eliminating cycling is preventing the moves, forbidding the moves for several iterations. But in simulated annealing, the method for preventing cycling is the rules of probability, the nature of probability. Okay. So these steps are given for a minimization problem. Assume we are solving a maximization problem. Then what shall be changed in these rules? Basically, again, we will calculate the delta in the same way, but in this case, delta less than or equal to zero means not an improvement. It's a non-improving move. So basically, we will change this. If delta is greater than zero, then except for a maximization problem. If delta is less than zero, then go and calculate this one. But in that case, this is problematic because if delta is less than zero, okay, what do we have? This value over here, e to the power value, we want it to be something negative. Okay, so initially when it was minimization problem, we are calculating this probability so that this delta is positive, t is positive, and this negative makes all of them negative, so it becomes in fact 1 over e to the power delta t. And the reason for this is basically to have a value between 0 and 1. Remember, probability values should always be between 0 and 1. But if delta is negative over here, let's say delta is minus 20, and if we calculate e to the power minus 20 over something positive, then this will be positive and it will be e to the power something and it will be larger than 1. And in fact, it is not a probability, it's something larger than 1. So again, we need to be careful in this case. Maybe it is better to represent this e to the power minus absolute value of this delta divided by t. Or if you like, you can just convert the maximization problem into minimization and use the same procedure at all. But if you don't want, you can use for maximization problem, you can change this to, okay, if delta is greater than zero, accept, otherwise reject. And when you are rejecting, calculate this one. Or you can do something else. Instead of calculating this delta as the difference between the neighbor minus current solution, you can say it current solution minus neighbor. And if you use in this way, then you will say delta less than or equal to zero, and you will calculate this. So if delta is less than or equal to zero, you will accept, and you will use exactly the same. So there are different ways of modifying for a maximization problem, whichever you liked, but the basic idea is this. If it is an improving move for a minimization, improvement means if the objective function value is decreased, or in a maximization problem, improvement means an increase in the objective function. If it's an improve, we always accept. If it is a non-improving move, if the objective function value deteriorates, then we need to calculate a probability, and in this probability we are using the difference between the current solution and the neighbor solution, and this delta must be always positive for a non-improving move. Okay, this delta must be positive for a non-improving move. It is the critical thing that in this modification for a maximization problem. Now let's consider this parameter of the simulated annealing, which is t. So in calculation of this probability, we said that we are calculating e to the power minus delta over t. So this is the temperature, but this temperature is not something constant. So we start with an initial temperature value, which is T0, and usually this initial temperature is selected to be very high. And when it is very high, this acceptance probability is very large, closer to 1. We will talk about it. And then during the iterations, we cool down this temperature, meaning that we reduce the value of T. And how do we reduce it? It is called a cooling schedule. There are different mechanisms to cool down it. For example, you can do like this. At every iteration, we multiply, we find the next value of tk plus 1 as, let's say, 0.9 times tk. Okay? If you start, for example, with 100 as t0, what happens? T0 is 100, then T1 becomes 100 times 0.9, which is 90, then T2 becomes 90 times 0.9, and it becomes 0.81, and then in T3, you multiply this 81 with 0.9, and you find the new value, and etc. Okay, so at each iteration, we reduce the value of this tk. So this is one method of cooling schedule, but why do we use 0.9? Maybe we can use 0.99. Maybe we can use 0.80. If it is 0.99, it will cool down slowly. If it is 0.80, it will cool down at a faster rate. Okay, and we will try to see the what happens if we use different values. So basically, in this scheme, we say that tk plus 1 is alpha times tk, where this alpha is less than 1, a value which is less than 1. We can say between 0 and 1. So this can be a cooling schedule. Or another cooling schedule can be like this. In every 10 iterations, reduce t by a rate of alpha. So what happens? So you start with t0 equals to, let's say, 100. Up to t9, you continue with 100. And when you go to the 10th iteration, you change it, its value from, with, let's say, multiplied by 0.9 with alpha, and you change it to 90. Then from T10 down to T19, you use 90. And when you go to T20, you use 81. And then up to T29, you use 81. So this is another cooling schedule. Okay. So different cooling schedule, different alpha values, etc., provides different solution values. If you cool down too fast, then it may stop in some local optimum too early. Again, with the help of this cooling schedule, you can balance the intensification and diversification. Remember our discussion with the tabu search. We say that if this is our search space, starting from an initial solution, we want to search different sides of the search space, different portions of the search space. But if at a certain point, at a certain region, if there are really good solutions, then we want to intensify in that region to, in order to find better solutions. But we don't want to just search this space. We want to diversify to the other portions as well. So we need to have a balance between intensification and diversification. And if your T0 value is too high, it means that accepting a non-improving move is the probability of accepting a non-improving move is larger. It means that you will move different portions, and if you cool slowly, okay, then this will have help diversification. And when the temperature is reduced to very smaller values, then the probability of accepting non-improving moves will be very small, so that only improving moves will start to be used, and it will help intensification. Okay, so by the help of this temperature and cooling schedule, helps intensification and diversification. So in order to diversify the search algorithm, and in order to escape from local optima, another strategy that you can use is to change the temperature, is to restart the temperature value. So what do? You start with T0 value, and at each step, you change its value with alpha times TK. And when the value of temperature is too smaller, then you set its value again T0 and restart from this T0 and start to cool down again. And by this way, what you would do is, okay, you will start from here. Initially, you will diversify the search, and through the end, you will start intensification in this region. And when you finish intensification in this region, you will set the temperature to a higher value again, so it will move to another portion of the feasible region, and then you will intensify there. Okay, so restarting the temperature helps intensifying in different portions of the feasible region. Also, in the success or in the performance of simulated annealing, the choice of neighborhood is also very important. This graph illustrates the acceptance probability function, how it behaves, and it's very important to understand this behavior. Remember, the acceptance probability is e to the power minus delta divided by t, temperature. Now assume that in this graph, this delta is a fixed value, let's say 50. Okay. So it means that our objective function worsens by 50 units. So assume we are making a minimization problem. We started with 850. This is current solution. And we selected a neighbor. And the value of the neighbor is 800. So we are making minimization. The value of the neighbor is 900. So the deterioration amount is 50 units. This is delta. Okay, so when delta is 50, so what happens if we use different values of temperature? So what happens to this function with delta equals to 50? So in fact, it is 1 over e to the 50 divided by t. Okay, if we use, for example, 2000 for t, we will have 1 over e to the 50 divided by 2000. Okay, so 50 divided by 2000 is a small number, and when it is a small number, this value over here is closer to 1. When it is closer to 1, the probability becomes 1 over 1, okay, which is the probability that we expect. When the temperature value is larger, we want this probability to be larger. So when we reduce the temperature to 500, for example, then the probability becomes 1 over e to the 50 divided by 500. And this e to the 50 divided by 500 is value is something greater than 1, maybe 2, and etc. So in that case, you see the probability of acceptance is around 0.60. So when we reduce the temperature, the probability is reduced. But remember, this function depends on both the temperature and the amount of worsening in the objective function. So now we are investigating the effect of the temperature. So what do we say? In simulated annealing, we start with a large temperature. So we want the acceptance probability to be closer to 1. So what does it mean? Initially, if we are searching this space, initially we will start from a point and we will check a random neighbor. And since the temperature is very high, even this neighbor is a worsening, non-improving move, we will most probably select it. Then from this one, we will select another one. So from this one, we will select another one. So at the initial phases of the simulated annealing, it is just like making a random search, accepting a neighbor independent of its value, something like this. But during the algorithm, we reduce the value of temperature step by step, meaning that we are trying to converge to a solution, a good solution, and then intensify around that solution. This is the basic idea of simulated annealing. Okay, now let's consider this function again. But this time, let this delta be, instead of 50, let's assume that it is a smaller value. It is 10. Over t. So this is when delta is 50. Now where should be this 10 when delta is 10? What should be the graph look like? Okay, so when there is a small amount of deterioration, then that graph should appear on top of this. Something like this. Okay, so this should be the case when delta is 10, because since delta is 10, the deterioration amount is smaller. We want to accept on the same temperature level, at the same temperature level, we want the acceptance probability of this small deterioration to be larger than the acceptance probability of this larger deterioration. Again, similarly, if delta value is much worse, let's say if it is 100, we want the graph to be like this, and the graph appears like that. So this function has a good probability. As you can see, its values are between 0 and 1, as long as this delta value is positive. Okay. So, and since this is probability, we want that value to be between 0 and 1. And it serves the purpose. When t is larger, initial temperature is larger, the acceptance probability is large. And when you cool it down, the acceptance probability reduces to smaller values. And also, when the amount of deterioration is larger, then the acceptance probability is smaller. But when the deterioration amount is smaller, the acceptance amount is larger. This is exactly what we want. So therefore, this function is a very good function that serves our purpose. After these explanations, we can present the algorithm for simulated annealing, like the table search algorithm. The initial phase is the initialization, step 0. So we start with an initial solution. This is an improvement algorithm and it requires an initial solution. It needs a stopping criteria like the tabu search algorithm. And in this example, the stopping criteria is given as an iteration limit, but it can be something else. Again, initially, we need an initial temperature value. In this algorithm, it's represented by Q, the temperature. And we want this to be large enough initially. Of course, how large it should be depends on the problem. So we cannot say that you should set Q to 1000. Maybe 1000 is smaller for a problem, but very large for another problem. So it depends on the problem, the instance. And this initial solution, we save its value as the incumbent solution. Like the tabu search algorithm, we always keep the best solution. It is the keeping the best solution in the memory of simulated annealing. The solution index t is set to 0. Again, very similar to the tabu search algorithm, step 1 is the stopping condition. If you are in a solution and if you try the neighbors randomly and you cannot find a feasible neighbor of this solution after many steps, then you should stop. It means that maybe there are no feasible neighbors of this solution. Or if the iteration count is reached to this stopping condition, then you stop. And when you stop, the incumbent solution in your hand is the best solution, the solution provided by simulated annealing. Then step 2, the next step, is we select randomly one of the neighbors. This is one of the differences of the simulated annealing algorithm from the tabu search algorithm. In tabu search algorithm, we were generating all neighbors and selecting the best one, but here we are randomly generating one of the neighbors, assuming this as a provisional neighbor, and we compute its objective function value. Okay. In this algorithm, different than what we have seen, they define this delta obj as the improvement amount. But until now, we thought of it as the deterioration amount. So it is not important only how you compare, how you make the acceptance criteria will be different. So I'm going to change this. Instead of improvement amount, I will say calculate delta as deterioration amount, so that we will have the consistent, the same function as we explained until now. Okay, so delta will be deterioration amount. So if it's a minimization problem, in a minimization problem, an increase from current solution to a new solution, if there is an increase, then this means a deterioration. In a maximization, from a current solution to a new one, if it's a decrease, then this will be a deterioration. And this deterioration amount, if there is deterioration, it's always positive. If there's improvement, it will always be negative. Okay, now the acceptance criterion, according to our definition over here, is this. If the new objective improves, we accept it. Otherwise, we accept with probability e to the power minus delta over q, okay? So we should have minus over here. If delta obj is greater than or equal to 0, and accept, in this case, accept and update our solution. So current solution becomes new solution. Otherwise, we return back to step 2 if we do not accept, if we reject this solution. We return back to step 2 to find another random neighbor and repeat these activities. Then the rest is similar to the tabu search algorithm. In step 4, we Update the incumbent solution. If we identified the best solution until now, we update the incumbent solution. Then we have this step 5 over here. In step 5, we say that we reduce the temperature according to our cooling schedule. We may have different cooling schedules. And in step 6, we increment our index iteration counter by 1 unit and return back to step 1. Okay, so in simulated annealing, we said that we need a stopping condition, and here in this algorithm, the stopping condition is given as T max, the number of iterations. But in some cases, in some simulated annealing algorithms, the stopping condition is given as a threshold value of temperature. So it says that if Q is less than, let's say, 10, then it says stop. So we start with a high value Q of Q, let's say 1000 Q0. Then we cool it down with a cooling schedule. We multiply it, let's say, by 0.95 at each iteration. And then when the temperature reduces below 10, we stop. So this is another stopping criteria that could be used with simulated annealing. So we can repeat, summarize some of these concepts. What do we do? We set the initial temperature to a high value. Then with a cooling schedule, we reduce this temperature. So we may, if you like, we can continue with the same temperature for certain number of iterations and then reduce it, or we can directly reduce it at each iteration. So for this purpose, we need a cooling schedule. And who determines the cooling schedule? You, as the designer of the simulated annealing, you decide on this. And basically, you do not just decide on this. What is done is you try different alternatives, different versions, and you select the best alternative that gives the shortest solution time and the best performance with respect to the solution value. The solution quality and speed are dependent on these choices. What are the choices? The neighborhood structure, the initial temperature, your cooling schedule. All these affect the solution quality and speed in simulated annealing. In order to understand the simulated annealing algorithm, let's consider the same knapsack example that we solved with double search. So this is the formulation of the knapsack problem. Again, like the double search algorithm or in any other meta-heuristic algorithm, to start the algorithm, we need to know about some parameters. We need to set some parameters and make some decisions. The first thing is, what kind of neighborhood shall we use? And it's given to us to use flip neighborhood. This is similar to the previous example. Then we are said that the temperature is 10. So this is the initial temperature. And this in this small example, we will not use any cooling schedule. So we will all use temperature to be 10. The starting solution, we need an initial solution, and it is given to us as 1000. The stopping condition is given to us as the number of iterations, and it is given as 3 iterations. Simulated annealing is a random algorithm, so it requires some random decisions at certain times. We select one of the neighbors randomly, first of all, and secondly, if a move is a non-improving move, we select one, we decide whether to accept it or not by a random number, by a function and generating a random number. So in illustrating this algorithm on a paper, of course, in with a computer, we can generate these random numbers by using the functions inside those algorithms. For example, In C++ or Java, you can just generate random numbers. But in order to illustrate on this paper, in these kind of examples, we are given a sequence of random numbers. So whenever we need a random number between 0 and 1, we use the first one in the sequence. Then when we are finished with it, we move to the second one. Whenever we need a second random number, we use the second one. Then we use the third one and etc. Okay, so it's also important to observe how we use these random numbers. Let's start and let's solve this example using the simulated annealing. And again, I'm going to use such a table to illustrate the steps of the algorithm. So the first step at T0, we are given this solution 1, 0, 0, and 0, and its value is 18 when you put it into the objective function. And this is the only integer solution that we know until now, so the incumbent solution is also 18. The temperature is 10, and it will be 10 all over the algorithm. Now we need to select a neighbor. And according to this flip neighborhood, let's remember, we can flip the first variable, x1. In that case, we will obtain this solution, 0, 0, 0, 0. We can flip the second one, and we will obtain 1, 1, 0, 0. We can flip the third one, we will obtain 1, 0, 1, 0. And the last one, we can complement it, and it will be 1, 0, 0, 1. So there are four possible neighbors, and we are going to select one of them. And the selection will be made randomly. It means that we are going to use these random numbers. We are going to use the first random number, 0.82. But how shall we do it? How shall we use this 0.82 to select one of these four decisions? So the basic thing we do is, okay, we have this 0 and 1 interval. This is 0, 1 interval. Since we are making, we have four decisions, we divide this region into four equal lengths. Okay, so it means that we can divide it into four equal portions, 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, and 1. So the first region over here will correspond to the first solution, so this will be 0, 0, 0, 0. This will correspond to the second solution. This will correspond to the third, and this will be the fourth one. Now what we will do, we will use the first random variable, which is 0.82, and 0.82 is somewhere here. So since the random number is in this interval, it means that we selected this last one. Okay, this is how we use these random numbers to select one of four decisions. If we need to select one of two decisions, so basically we would divide the interval into two. If we need to select one of three alternatives, then we need to divide this region into three. Okay? So the lengths of the intervals should be equal to each other, so that we are selecting with equal probability, we are selecting one of them. Okay, so let me clear this part and let's continue. According to our first random number, we selected the last neighbor, and last neighbor means complementing the fourth decision variable. Okay, so here I am going to write complemented variable is x4. You can just write x4 or j equal to 4. And when we complement the fourth variable, the solution is 1001. And when you plug in into this 1001 into objective function, you will obtain 32. Okay? Then when this is 32, we need to calculate the change in the objective function. In simulated annealing, we said that this delta represents the amount of deterioration, amount of worsening in the objective function. So since this is a maximization problem, moving from 18 to 32 is not deterioration, it is improving. So if it is improving, we will represent it negative. So it means that we will subtract 18 minus 32, which is minus 14. Okay, so this is just a conversion because the main objective is to have this e to the delta over t. In this, we want this delta to be positive so that with this negative, it will give us a number between 0 and 1. Okay, so if it's a deterioration, we want this delta to be positive in this function. Therefore, for that purpose, we are subtracting 32 from 18 to obtain minus 14, which means an improvement. And since this is an improvement, we will definitely accept without calculating that function. We will accept this. Whenever it's improvement, whenever this is less than zero, we will accept. Okay, so this is the first step. Now we move to t equal to 1, and the current solution is 1, 0, 0, 1, and the value of the objective function is 32, and the incumbent value is 32, q is never changed, it is 10. Okay, and then now we need to find a new neighbor randomly, and you see again we have four alternatives, x1, x2, x3 and x4. So we are going to select one of these four alternatives again randomly, 0.25, 0.5 and 0.75. Now we are going to use the next random number, which is 0.93, and 0.93 is in this interval. It means that we again selected x4. You see now, complementing x4 1 in the first step and a second time in the second step may lead to a cycling behavior. But it's perfectly fine with simulated annealing. We do not ignore it, but we just let the probability, the randomness, to avoid this. Okay? So, let's see what happens. Again, if we complement x4, the new solution is 1000, and the new objective function value is 18, and the previous one was 32, and from 32 to 18 for a maximization problem is a worsening, is a deterioration. And it means that our delta is 32, the previous current solution minus 18, which is plus 14. Okay, now since this is a worsening, we need to make a decision over here. We do not directly accept it, but what do? We calculate e to the power minus delta over t, or q in our case, okay? So e to the power minus 14 divided by 10. And when you calculate this value with the calculator, it is 0.247. Okay, now this is the probability of accepting, this non-improving solution. But this doesn't say anything about our decision. It just gives us the probability value. Then how shall we make this decision? Basically, we will use the same idea. Okay, if this is the region between 0 and 1, why we are always considering this region 0 and 1? Because our random numbers are given in this region between 0 and 1. So we divide this region 0 and 1 so that one part of it will constitute 24.7% of the whole region, so that the probability will be 24.7%. So basically, what does it mean? This is 0.247. We will just use this number over here, and we will say that, okay, this part over here is the probability of acceptance, and this part over here is the probability of rejection. Now, what shall we do? We will generate a random number between 0 and 1. If it fails in the acceptance region, we accept it. If it is in the other region, we reject it. Basically, we will make our decision in this way. So we already use 0.93. The next one that we will use is 0.33, and 0.33 is here, which means that we will reject. So the outcome is to reject this move. Okay, so we tried a neighbor. It was a worst neighbor, non-improving move, and using this probability of acceptance, we rejected it. Now, what shall we do? We will return back to the previous solution, which is still 1001, and we will generate a new neighbor. Okay, so this 1001, this. So you see, since we didn't move to a new neighbor, I didn't increment the t value. Whenever we make a move, whenever we accept a move, it is a one step. So we didn't make a step now. We are still at the same solution, and we will try to find a new neighbor. And in this case, we are going to use the next random number, which is 0.21. Since that 0.21 is in this region, 0.25, 0.21 is here, so we divide it into four equal parts because of these four neighbors. And since 0.21 is the first interval here, it means that we are going to flip or complement the first variable. Okay, now we tried 4, we couldn't do it. We will try x1, and what is the objective function value when we complement it? The solution is 0001. So when we plug in these values into our objective function, the new objective function value is 14. So the previous was 32, the new is 14, and again, this is not an improving move, this is a deteriorating move, and the amount of worsening is 18. So do not just say, okay, it is 18, it is worse, if 14 is not accepted, this will not be accepted. No. Maybe because of the random number, although it is a worse move, it may be still selected. Okay, it is just randomness. Of course, worsening for 18 units is worse than 14. So there is a less chance of selecting this one according to the function, but still it may be selected. Therefore, we will let the randomness do its task. So what shall we do? We will calculate again e to the power minus 18 divided by 10, and this value is 0.165. again, shall we accept this one or not? This is the acceptance probability. You see, the acceptance probability is very small, but still we are going to use the next random number, which is 0.09. So 0.09 is somewhere here, which means that we are accepting. So you may ask, why the acceptance region is here and rejection region is here? Why not vice versa? Basically, it is that part, because this 0.165 tells us that the acceptance probability is 16.5%. So the region that we are allocating for acceptance should be 16.5% of the whole region. So if this is the whole region 100%, this part is 16.5%. Okay, so that's why we are selecting this part, we are using this part. And according to our next random number, which is 0.09, the outcome is to accept. Okay, so now we found a new neighbor, which is accepted. It means that we made a new move. Okay. So we can write t is equal to 2, and we are currently in this solution 0, 0, 0, 1. Objective function value is 14. Incumbent value, we never forget, 32. And we do not cool down. Okay, if we use, for example, such a cooling schedule, qt plus 1 equals to qt times, let's say, 0.9. In this case, we shall use at this step not 10 but 9, and at this step we will use 8.1. at each step we will multiply the previous Q by 0.9 to obtain the new temperature. But in this solution, in this example, there is no cooling schedule, so we are using the same value, same temperature all around. Okay, now again, we need to generate, we need to select one of the neighbors randomly. Again, there are four alternatives, so we will divide this interval into four parts: 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, 1, and 0. So each has an equal probability of selection, and the next random number is 0.64, and 0.64 corresponds to this one here, which corresponds to x3 variable. Okay, so we will try x3 now, complementing x3. And when we complement x3, what happens? The solution is 0, 0, 1, 1. When we plug in this in our objective function, we obtain a solution value of 25. Okay, our current solution is 14 and the new solution is 25, and you see that the result is minus 11, and this minus means improvement. Since it is an improvement, we accept this move. Okay, do not need to calculate the acceptance probability, just accept it. Okay, now we move to the third iteration, and in this iteration we have this solution with objective function value 25, but the incumbent value is 32. So here we made one step, we made second step, and we made third step. So we generated one solution, second solution, and third solution. And since this is the third solution, according to our stopping criterion, which is three iterations, we stop. And when we stop, what is the solution? The solution is not 25. It is not the current solution. It is the incumbent solution. The solution that we found is 32. Okay, so 32, and where did we find that solution? We find that solution over here. So this is how simulated annealing algorithm works. As you see, it is a random algorithm, and it prevents cycling behavior with the use of randomness. And for this example, it is also important to know how to use such random numbers, given random numbers. I hope it is this example clarified the algorithm. And as a designer of such simulated annealing algorithms, the performance of the algorithm depends on your neighborhood. By using a different neighborhood, you may obtain better solution. Initial temperature and cooling schedule is very important and affects the performance of the algorithm. Starting solution may affect the performance of the algorithm. You can use a different starting solution and come up with a different final solution. And the stopping criteria is also important. Instead of making three iterations, if you stop after 30 iterations, of course, you may end up with a better solution. But the thing is, making 30 iterations rather than three iterations requires 10 times more computational time. Okay, so there is a trade-off. If you increase the stopping criteria condition, you will end up with longer process time, computational time, but maybe better and improved objective function value. And of course, as I said, you can use other stopping criteria, not just the number of iterations. You can use some other criteria as well. Let's talk about this stopping criteria. What are the possible stopping conditions for metaheuristic algorithms? So in metaheuristic algorithms, since we do not stop when we just identify a local optimal solution, like in local search algorithms, since we allow non-improving moves, we need a stopping condition, as we mentioned. And in many of these algorithms, there are some common stopping criteria that can be used, but use of each one of these may affect the performance of the algorithm. So there is no single way of stopping these algorithms, and depending on the problem and depending on the instance, depending on the algorithm, you may use a different stopping condition. So what are the usual stopping or most widely used stopping conditions in such algorithms? So it can be the number of iterations, as we used in our examples. You can use a tmax value and say that 5 iterations or 50 iterations. 5 is very small, by the way. It's just an example on paper. If you are using a computer, the number of iterations can be thousands. Okay, so you can use such an iteration counter. And how does it work? You start from an initial solution, you jump to a new solution, and this is iteration 1. You jump to another solution, this is iteration 2. Jump to another one, iteration 3. You count these, and when you reach the number 50, you stop. Okay, this is one method of stopping. The other stopping condition is similar to this, but it just counts the number of consecutive non-improving iterations. And when these non-improving iteration count reaches to a threshold value, it stops. For example, we can say that stop after 20 non-improving iterations. Okay. So how does it work? Let's consider a minimization example. So we start, let's say, with a value of 500, and then we jump to a new neighbor. So in fact, here you are counting the non-improving iterations, and not according to current solution, according to incumbent solution. Okay, so you should check the incumbent. Let me write incumbent over here. So when you have 500, your solution is 500. Then from 500 for a minimization problem, let's assume that we jump to 450. So this is 450, and I am going to write number of non-improving iterations to here. Non-improving iterations. Okay, so since we improved here, there is the number of non-improving iterations is 0 from 500 to 450. Since its value is improved, we do not count it. Then from 450, let's assume that the neighbor has a value of 470. So this is a non-improving move. So we count it to 1, and incumbent solution is 450. Then we move to another neighbor. Let's assume that this is 460. Look, with respect to current solution, it is improved. It's an improvement. But we are checking with the incumbent solution, and incumbent solution is 450. And with respect to 450, this 460 is not an improvement. So it means that we increase the number of non-improving moves to 2. Incumbent is still 450. This is, we can write the number of iterations, total number of iterations to here. So we made 1 iteration, 2 iteration, 3 iterations. And in 3 iterations, the number of non-improving iterations is 2. And from this one, we can move to a solution which has a value of 420. Now this 420 is less than our incumbent solution. So it means that in iteration 4, the incumbent solution is improved. So we reset the number of non-improving iterations to 0 and we start counting again. Again, from 420, if we move to, let's say, 510, in iteration 5, number of non-improving moves is 1, and incumbent solution is still 420. Then we may move to, let's say, 435, then iteration 6, number of non-improving moves is 2, and incumbent solution is still 420, and etc. And when the number of non-improving moves reaches to 20, we stop it. Okay, this is how the second criteria works. In number of iterations in the first one, we do not look if it is improved or not. We just stop at the point at the, whenever we reach the iterations. Okay, both of them have their advantages and disadvantages. Basically, the advantage of the first one is the solution time is always similar for a similar sized problem. When you run the algorithm again and again, you will stop after, let's say, 50 iterations. It will not go to the 60th iteration. But when you use the second algorithm, okay, so you may reach the number of 20 non-improving iterations, maybe in after 50 real iterations, or when you run the algorithm a second time, maybe it will take 100 iterations to reach this number 20. So from one run to another, the solution time may be different. Okay, so the third stopping criteria can be reaching a threshold parameter value, like we explained in simulated annealing. You start with a high temperature value, and with a cooling schedule, you cool down its value, and you say that, okay, whenever you reach a threshold value, which is 10, you stop. Okay? This can be your stopping condition. By the way, you can use multi-start strategy in meta-heuristic algorithms, and what you can do, you start from an initial solution with a higher temperature in simulated annealing, let's say, and you come to a stopping condition after several iterations or with a threshold temperature value, and when you reach this one, you say that, okay, go to the starting solution, find another initial solution, and repeat the algorithm, then return back and repeat the algorithm, and you can do this several times. So you can put a time limit on that, or a number of repetitions, number of restarts, and you can stop after this in order to improve the solution quality. But of course, don't ever forget, if in heuristic algorithms, if you want to improve solution quality, most probably you will lose from solution time. Okay, there's a trade-off between time and quality. If you want better solutions, you need to increase your search time. And increasing search time will lead to longer total times to solve the problem. Another alternative is to just, instead of counting the iterations, you can just put a time limit. You can say that stop after 5 minutes. Okay, in 5 minutes, if it makes 20 iterations, it will stop after 20 iterations. If it makes 200 iterations, it will stop after 200 iterations. So you are not interested in the number of iterations, you are interested in the total time that it takes. Okay, so this may be problematic if you are solving problems with different sizes. For example, if you are using a TSP instance with 20 cities, and if you are solving a problem with 200 cities, so for this one, in 5 minutes, you can make, let's say, 1,000 iterations, maybe. But for this one, since the number of cities is larger, evaluating the objective function, finding the neighbors, and etc., will take more time. So your total number of iterations may be less, maybe 200. So although this problem is more complex, meaning that you need more search, more iterations to come up with a solution, a better solution, since you limited its time, you are making less iterations. But of course, it all depends on how much time do you have to solve this problem. And you can use any other meaningful solution or stopping criteria. It is just limited with your imagination. But the thing is, which of these stopping conditions are the best, we don't know. So you need to try them. You need to make tests to understand which one is better for your own problem. So this is the end of our discussion for simulated annealing.